This week, there was this news story about a woman in Australia who started having some very serious symptoms. You'll see all sorts of clickbaity titles all over the internet, such as "Freaky Australia's Foraging Community Shocked After Parasitic Worm Found in Woman's Brain." This is actually not the worst title I've seen. Anyways, so basically, this is written, I think, more from the perspective of the foraging community, because the way that the woman got the worm in her brain is that she had been out picking these special types of wild grasses, and the grasses happened to be in an area where there were a lot of these snakes that were infested with these parasitic roundworms. And what happens is the parasitic roundworms will go, they'll basically lay their eggs, I believe, inside of the python. I think it's a python. I forget what kind of snake it is. We'll look that up in a second. The carpet python. So the legs will be laid inside of the python, and then when it poops, the poop will end up in the foliage. And some of this foliage happened to be the greenery that this woman was foraging for. And I guess she didn't wash it off good enough, or maybe the eggs, they're so small, it's impossible to get them all off of the greenery. So she accidentally ingested the eggs of this roundworm. And so then the eggs, what happens is when they're in their secondary host, what happens is the eggs will go into the bloodstream, and the bloodstream will disseminate the eggs throughout the body, and then the eggs will go and embed themselves in various tissues. Normally, their target is like the muscle, but sometimes they can cross the blood-brain barrier, which is pretty, I don't want to say it's rare because it's not really that rare, but it should be hard for large-ish things to pass the blood-brain barrier because it's very restrictive, because we don't want, you know, like we don't even want certain immune cells to be getting into the blood-brain barrier easily, unless they're called there. So anyways, these eggs made it into her brain, and then the roundworm was born. And there are some lovely pictures. If you don't like looking at worms, you might want to skip this next bit. But yeah, anyways, so she was a 64-year-old woman from southeastern New South Wales. I'm guessing that's a territory in Australia. This actually happened last year, but I guess they're reporting on it now, which is strange. I don't know why. But anyways, she had an 8-centimeter long, so it was 8 centimeters long, which is about this long, live parasitic roundworm pulled from her brain. And this was the first time that a parasitic roundworm had been reported being in a human brain. Doctors and scientists hypothesized that the roundworm called Ophida scaris robertsi worm eggs could have been shed by a carpet python in grasses and warrigal greens, which is what she was harvesting, at the lake where the patient collected them. So it's hypothesized we don't actually know how the eggs got into her brain. They believe she was probably infected with the parasite from touching the grasses and transferring the eggs to food or kitchen utensils, or after eating the greens. Why are these people surprised? It's Australia. Everything is trying to kill humans there. Yeah, yeah. No, that's true. Caff, where was her immune system during all of this? So again, the roundworm, so typically roundworms themselves can trigger a type 2 response. So there's these CD4 T cells in your body called T helper 2s, and they are pretty good at recognizing and eliciting an immune response against helminths and parasites. But I do have a paper that I was trying to figure out why is it that the eggs are basically invisible to the immune system, because like basically the eggs have to travel through the bloodstream. Well, first they have to travel. Let's think about this. If she ingested it, it was in her stomach. So does that mean that the eggs hatched in her stomach? I don't think so. This is a good point, because at some point the eggs would need to be, they would need to leave the gut, and then they would need to get into the bloodstream. Yeah, I'm not sure exactly how that happened. We'll figure that out. So when the eggs go to the brain, they're basically, so this is, now I'm getting confused with tapeworms, but they are able to kind of evade the immune response up until the point where they start dying. And when they start dying, they release like things like, I don't know, their DNA, for example. And when there's DNA outside of a cell, it triggers the immune response. But anyhow, let's see if they talk a little bit more about that, about how they think, because I don't think they really know what happened in between her ingesting the foliage and then getting the roundworm in her brain. Because again, this is the first time this particular thing has happened in a human, so we don't really know what the life cycle of the roundworm is like in a human. Okay. So, okay, this is mostly talking about why you shouldn't forage. I mean, if you're going to be foraging, you should be careful, because there are other things that you can get while foraging, such as you could be bitten by spiders or you can get giardia. Okay, so let's see, more foraging. People are talking about why they like to forage. That's really fun. Let's look at another article about this. Hang on. There was Wargle Greens. Most of these are very like brief articles. Let me see what the life cycle of this is. So let's look at a picture. So first of all, this is what the roundworm looked like. Bean.
Welcome to the Caffeine Club.
I don't know if you guys can see this. Blessing! Oh my god! Blessing! You're from New Zealand, which is very close to Australia. Also, thank you for the 26 months! My goodness! My goodness! I can't believe it's been that long. Holy crap. We are talking about the roundworm that was pulled from a woman's brain in Australia. And basically, this is a picture of it. Hang on, let me pull this over. Oh, now I have to make this big again. Nope, that's not the right thing. Let's just pull this. There we go. This is what it looked like when it came out of her brain. It grew quite a lot. Oh my god, Styx is here. Hello, welcome to the stream. I see. Probably hatched lower in the digestive tract and burrowed into the intestinal walls. That's also a very good hypothesis, Ip. We're trying to figure out how the roundworm went from being just eggs to actually making it all the way through her blood-brain barrier and into her brain. Yeah, because this is the first time this type of roundworm has actually been able to survive and live inside of a human. Normally, these are found in things like snakes, also koala bears, which is kind of sad, marsupials. What if she touched her eye and had the eggs on her hand? So there are actually some very gross pictures of roundworms in people's eyes. I will not show them to you all because it is very disturbing, but that is a possibility. There's also another weak point, I guess, that in our bodies that allows access into our brain. And this is actually how brain-eating amoeba get into our brain. So there's something called the cribriform plate that's inside of your nose. The cribriform plate, let's get a picture of it. I don't know if you guys can see this. Let's get this. This is the classic cribriform plate picture that, everyone likes to look at. So this is inside of your nose. Now these holes allow like the olfactory nerves to come through and go like from your brain into your nose, basically. Now this area is not as protected as the blood-brain barrier. So sometimes if you're swimming, for example, in fresh water and you happen to, I don't know, snort a bunch of water, it's possible that the amoeba, if there's like brain-eating amoeba, they can like go through the cribriform plate and up into your brain in this way. So it's possible maybe that if you are, I don't know, if you have the eggs of a parasite on your hand and you somehow like get them in your nose. Again, that seems like very unlikely, but potentially possible. I don't think anyone is going to willingly inoculate their nose with roundworm eggs, but it is quite possible that they could enter the brain through this area as well. It's 5 a.m. here, and you're making some coffee. Nice. Very nice. Why are you up so early, Styx? I know some people get up very early. I am actually a very late riser. I wake up at 7:30. I try to wake up at 6:30. Some mornings I wake up at 6:30, and some mornings I wake up at 7:30. And some mornings I wake up at 9. I'm about to make some coffee. Oh, you guys are all making coffee. I love that. Is it also morning for you, Nakura? Man, the cost of fresh produce must be so high in Australia that people go foraging. I think it's really that they're trying to keep some sort of like their culture alive, maybe. There's also, I think, certain greens out there that are maybe beneficial if you're like an herbal into herbal things. Maybe you think that drinking a particular tea made from some sort of grass is going to help you, but I'm skeptical about that. That was the last message I was grabbing. Oh, I was like, what is 96 plus? Is that my age? In New Zealand for now, Caff. Oh, I know you're in New Zealand. You're moving to Australia in 2 weeks. Our friend, okay, guys, our friend Blessing is moving to Australia soon. Very exciting. Are you moving to a part of Australia that is full of wildlife, or are you moving to the city? Was going to say that. What about through the mucosal membranes in the nose? Yeah, no, that's a possibility as well. Someone died from an amoeba here in Austin recently? Really? So deaths from brain-eating amoebas doesn't happen often. I believe since the first reported case of brain-eating amoebas, there was only, I think, a couple hundred people who have died from the brain-eating amoeba. It is fatal. In most cases, unless miraculously you start treatment early. However, by the time the symptoms start to manifest, it's usually too late for the patient. But I'm curious about this amoeba case in Austin. Oh, 1 day ago. Oh, man. Okay, let's check this out. Sorry, I need to... Ugh, so many ads. Let me reframe this yet again. There we go. This is a child ad. Sorry, I don't mean to show you children. Let's see. Okay, moving back. So a resident in Texas has died from a brain-eating amoeba after swimming in a lake near Austin. The individual, who is not named, was diagnosed with Naegleria fowleri, which kills 99% of people it infects. So here's the thing. There is a treatment, I believe... Is it an antibiotic? There is definitely a drug that kills Naegleria fowleri, but by the time it's administered, it's too late. Local health officials revealed they had been swimming in Lake Lyndon B. Johnson and urged others to avoid swimming in the water. So this was a freshwater case. God, hang on. I just want to crop. I'm just very anal about ads. I don't like them. Just really annoying to me. Okay, the patient is thought to be at least the fourth U.S. casualty from the amoeba this year. Wow. After a resident in Georgia, they had their two-year-old boy in Nevada and a man in Florida all died after contracting the disease. So this is the lake where it happened. Okay, there are more ads, unfortunately. This is a story about the boy who died from getting the brain-eating amoeba as well. These infections are rare, but there are these microbes that are present in natural bodies of water that can pose risks of infection. Increased temperatures over the summer make it ideal for harmful microorganisms to grow and flourish. Yeah, so Naegleria fowleri are not the only things you guys should be concerned about if you're swimming in freshwater areas, because it's possible that there could also be like algal blooms, and there's, I think it's blue algae, cyanobacteria that make toxins. And these toxins are actually can be fatal for animals. And then they're toxic for humans. So not good stuff. I don't mean to be an anti-child stream. I just thought you weren't supposed to show like random children on stream, but they are on the internet. So I don't know why I'm worried. Interesting. Sounds a lot like rabies too. Once the symptoms show, it has a 99% fatality rate. Yeah, it's so even though it's similar, they're working by different mechanisms because basically the Naegleria fowleri, they cause a lot of inflammation in the brain. But by that point, there's so many of them, it's hard to treat. And at that point, there's so much inflammation and like swelling in the brain that the person usually dies from that. People can catch the amoeba when water goes up their nose, which may happen during swimming, diving, or submerging the head in water. So just a friendly PSA to all of you out there, when you're swimming in fresh waters, maybe don't stick your nose under the water. I know this is very hard to do, and we can't live our life in fear, but just saying, there's a risk. There's also a risk that if someone splashes the water and it goes up your nose, it's possible the amoeba can go up your nose that way as well. Oh my God. What is this? Okay. So many ads. The lake is gross this summer. Yeah, probably don't go in it then. Warm water, still water is to be avoided. Absolutely. That's where a lot of these algal blooms happen. Oh, you watched the Kurzgesagt on it. What is this? Dude, what are these ads? I'm going to have to... I feel like my computer's getting a virus. Okay, you know what? I think my computer is infected. I just want to finish this article. So it says there were 157 cases recorded between 1962 and 2022. So only 157 people, which is still a lot of people, have gotten this amoeba, this brain-eating amoeba. So less than 3 cases per year. 39 of these, or 25% of these cases, were in Texas, which is kind of disturbing. So if you live in Texas and you're swimming in fresh water, be careful. Experts fear, however, that infections with the amoeba are starting to become more common as rising temperatures, heat, lakes, rivers, and standing bodies of water. The organism lives in fresh water and multiplies whenever the water temperature rises above 77 degrees Fahrenheit. Here is a fake image of what these amoebae look like. They don't actually look like that. They're a lot more boring. This is just a computer rendition. Okay, so then it goes on to talk about other popular lakes where people are visiting. So just be careful out there. You don't know what you might get up your nose. Caff's computer has a worm or an amoeba. A worm or an amoeba. Yeah, that would be kind of funny if I had an amoeba infection inside of my monitor. That would be kind of fun. They could be like my pets. Bacon fish, hello. A sign that you're not using an ad blocker and you're on clickbait sites and on a clickbait site. You know, you're right. My ad blocker isn't turned on. I think I must have turned it off for this browser for some reason, and I don't know why, but I'm going to have to fix that. Yes, Texas. Hey, Texas is always says they do everything bigger and better. Apparently that includes getting organisms as well. Yeah, no, I think it must have to do more with the temperature in Texas. And yes, climate change is making an impact. I know some people might not believe in climate change, but there are a lot of ramifications, including the types of microorganisms that are going to start just blooming and proliferating and living much happier lives because the temperature is overall warmer for them. I'll only go swimming in a cesspool. What even is a cesspool? Okay, so going back to our little story about this parasite, let's see. I wanted to find a picture of the life cycle, but I don't know. Here's another article. I don't know if they have anything a little bit more detailed. Okay, I think my ads are really... I should have turned my ad blocker on. Let's pull this open a little bit. Yep, ads. You guys can see what a potato I am. All right. There's the worm. So small and cute. Okay, we already know it was an 8-centimeter or 3-inch worm. It's a never-before-seen phenomenon in human medicine that a roundworm has ended up in a brain. One thing that is not new is that tapeworms end up in human brains. So I don't know if you guys can see this picture. If you're afraid of holes, look away. This is a human brain overrun with cysts from Tinea solium, a tapeworm that normally inhabits the muscles of pigs. And this has been pretty well documented. People do get parasitic roundworms alarmingly. Actually, there's an alarming number of people that have these cysts in their brains. These cysts can remain dormant for years of their life, and they can be asymptomatic until the cyst starts to degrade and die, at which point it then triggers the immune response, resulting in epilepsy. And other neurological issues, and that then causes the patient to go in, and then that's usually when they do like an MRI or something, and they see these cysts, which you can, this is what it looks like under MRI. Let me find, so they're kind of calcified, which is kind of gross and weird. Let's see, what is this? Is this a calcified? I don't know if this is caused by a roundworm. I just typed in calcified cysts, or sorry, tapeworm. This is different. So this is a tapeworm now. Tapeworms do get into the brain, and this is actually because when humans happen to eat, like, let's say raw pork. So actually, I want to find the life cycle of a tapeworm. I think they have it here. Basically, the eggs from the tapeworm will go and end up in the bloodstream and then embed themselves into the brain instead of the muscle in the human. But normally, the adult tapeworms are supposed to be kind of like pooped out or removed from the human at some point, and then they will lay their eggs somewhere else. But there's this like interruption in the life cycle that results in accidental tapeworms getting into the brain. That was a horrible explanation. I'll explain it better in a second. A cesspool is where wastewater from toilets is collected. Yeah, I would like to swim there too, Bacon. That's delightful. Will I become a zombie cockroach like with parasitic wasps? Why do you want to become a zombie cockroach? This is why I don't go swimming except in pools and water parks. Ooh, water parks are gross too, though. I'll be honest, though. I've gone to water parks. Also, Fire King, welcome into the stream tonight. Let me give you a quick little shout out. If you're gonna... Oh, you said you're usually going to bed. I thought you were going to bed right now. You go to bed at 9 a.m.? What is your sleep schedule? My goodness. You are a nocturnal being. I don't know if this shout out's going to work, but guys, go check out Fire King. Oh man, I just realized I was very behind. Guys, go check out Fire King. He's an awesome, wonderful streamer who also plays Dead by Daylight and other things as well. I still think the zombie slug parasite is one of my favorites. Yeah, we'll have to do another zombie slug video watching day. I really enjoy anything. Any type of parasite that zombifies its host, I love that. Okay, so moving along, I keep jumping all over the place. Are we done talking about the roundworm? No, we were still talking about the roundworm. So let's see. This is an unprecedented event that's being detailed in the Emerging Infectious Diseases Journal. I've never heard of them. It marks a monumental leap in our understanding of parasitic infections. Well, to be honest, okay, I wonder if they actually published something in this journal about this worm. Roundworm brain. Because I would like to know the mechanism. Okay, they wrote a case report. They wrote a case report on this woman. They know that it's the larva. Oh, no, now they're talking... Oh, they're talking about the tapeworm. Yeah. Do they actually have... Neuroscience news. Okay, we're getting closer. Cancel. Let's look at all these things. Parasitic worm. Do-do-do. The roundworm. Okay. This is everything we know. She contracted the parasite from Warrigal Greens. It was found in her brain. The first for any mammalian species. But let's see. Oh, so this was also something. The roundworm was pulled from her brain after brain surgery, and it was still alive and still wiggling. It is suspected that larvae or juveniles were also present in other organs in the woman's body, including the lungs and the liver. Oh my God. Normally, the larvae from roundworms are found in mammals and marsupials, which are eaten by the python, which then allows the life cycle to complete itself. So then they can lay the eggs in the python. Scarus robertsi roundworms are common to carpet pythons. They typically live in a python's esophagus and stomach, and they shed its eggs in the host feces. Humans infected with this roundworm larvae would be considered accidental hosts. Roundworms are incredibly resilient and able to thrive in a wide range of environments. In humans, they can cause stomach pain, vomiting, diarrhea, appetite, and weight loss. So I guess, I mean, obviously other roundworms have been consumed and live in humans' guts, I presume. So that's not new. There are zombie slugs. Yes. Oh my God, you're going to distract me, Ender. I really want to show you, but we'll talk about zombie slugs another time. Parasite that zombifies the host. That sounds like a lot like marriage. Bacon, I think you need to speak to somebody about that. I will say, I'm not married, so I wouldn't know. They published a case study. Oh, hey, Corey, welcome in. I'll have to find that case study. This is still just an article. That's not the actual case study. I'll keep looking, though. Hiren Cujo, welcome to the stream. What the fuck did I just come in on here on topic? We're talking about the roundworm that was found in the woman's brain. After this article, I'm going to look once more to see if I could just find the case study. I should have prepared a little bit more, but I was in a rush. Corey, yes, if you have the link. Oh, hang on. Can you post the link in the Discord? Unfortunately, I have links turned off right now, and I don't remember how to quickly turn them back on for certain viewers, just because usually I only have like special community members post links. The Discord would be better for that. Wait, Corey, I feel like I've seen you in another science streamer's stream. Do you go into Homozygote's stream? I'm trying to figure out where I've seen you. Your name is so familiar. Anyhow, so the researchers say the woman in Australia likely caught the roundworm after collecting a type of native grass, which is called warrigal, besides a lake near where she lived, and there were pythons had shed the parasite, presumably through its feces. So they're all just guessing that she got this through eating the greens. Her symptoms started back in January 2021. She initially developed abdominal pain and diarrhea, followed by fever, cough, and shortness of breath. In retrospect, these symptoms were likely due to migration of roundworm larvae from the bowels into other organs, such as the liver and lungs. Respiratory samples and a lung biopsy were performed. However, no parasites were identified in these specimens. Interesting. I mean, just because you don't, a biopsy is such a small sample size. I mean, it would obviously be awful to take multiple biopsies of a lung for obvious reasons. So it's possible that they just didn't biopsy the section that was infected. Another way that one could go about seeing if there are other, or at least if there's an immune response to potentially other roundworms in the body, is to look for any types of antibodies that are made against the roundworm. I don't know if they know what antibodies are made against this particular roundworm, but they don't mention that here. Usually, so for tapeworms, people are diagnosed with tapeworm infections if their serum or their blood has a high level of antibodies against the tapeworm. Took them around 1.5 years until they finally found the worm. Oh, you're in homozygote, Astro Canucks, Mahoodle Stream. Oh my goodness. Okay, I follow all of those people. Okay. You'll post it in the Discord. Okay, thanks. I'll go grab it in a second. My guess is the woman did not cook her greens. Lots of people think raw food is healthier. They forget the planet wants us dead. I mean, it's technically good to at least steam your vegetables. If you're trying to get the healthy benefits, sometimes it's not good to entirely cook the heck out of them, you know? But still, I think if you know that you're harvesting something from an area that has parasites, if you have that knowledge, you probably should not do that just for your own health, you know? At the time, trying to identify the microscopic larvae, which had never previously been identified as causing human infection, was a bit like trying to find a needle in a haystack. And this is presumably why it took so long for them to publish the article. In 2022, so this is about a year later, she began experiencing subtle changes in memory and thought processing and underwent a brain MRI scan, which demonstrated an atypical lesion within the right frontal lobe of the brain. I don't think they show the picture here, but the case study would have that, which I'll pull up after this. The patient was first admitted to a local hospital in late January in 2021 after suffering 3 weeks of abdominal pain and diarrhea, followed by constant dry coughs and fever and night sweats. By 2022, I hope you guys are paying attention to these symptoms, just in case you ever have like weird dry coughs, fevers, and night sweats and diarrhea and abdominal pain. I know these are very common symptoms, but sometimes, you know, it's always good to be in tune with your body, just in case. By 2022, the patient was experiencing forgetfulness and depression. Oh my God, our fellow Australian is here. Our resident Australian, Gronk, welcome to the stream. How are you? So Gronk, we are talking about the Australian woman who had a roundworm in her brain. Have you ever had a roundworm? Hopefully not. Wow, that's crazy, but I'm going to go back to lurking. All right, Iron. I hope you have a lovely evening. Thanks for the lurk. Okay, sounds like the fact that this kind of worm was never found in a human before really made it take longer to diagnose. Yeah. You're taking notes for the quiz. Good job. Quick conversion for the Americans. 8 centimeters is 3.3 inches. 3.3 inches. I can't speak. Thank you for that conversion. So 3.3 inches. This is how long, sort of, the worm was. Just like that. So it's pretty substantial, and it did show up in her MRI scan, which I saw somewhere, but I don't have it in this article right now. So while she was in the hospital in 2022, a neurosurgeon at Canberra Hospital explored the abnormality, and it was then that the unexpected 8-centimeter roundworm was found. Its identity was later confirmed through parasitology experts, initially through its appearance and then through molecular studies. So this is also what makes this type of diagnosis difficult, is that these parasites, I'm guessing that not a lot of people study parasites that live in carpet pythons, because they generally don't have an impact on humans, and so therefore funding is not really available for those kinds of studies. So they knew somewhat about their appearance, but they didn't even probably have a good molecular profile on these parasites. So there was this professor said the world first case highlighted the danger of diseases and infections passing from animals to humans. I don't understand the sentence. This highlights the danger of passing new types of infections from animals to humans as we start to live more closely together and our habitats overlap more and more. There have been about 30 new infections in the world in the last 30 years. Of the emerging infections globally, about 75% are zoonotic, which means that there's a transmission from the animal to the human. This includes coronaviruses. I'm sure we're all familiar with this, and I will not get into that territory right now. The Ophidioscus infection does not transmit between people, supposedly, so it won't cause another pandemic. Yeah, it's very rare to really get parasitic pandemics. just because usually they're spread like through the fecal oral route, which is, you know, that's pretty preventable. However, the snake and parasite are found in other parts of the world, so it is likely that other cases will be recognized in coming years in other countries. Okay, people who garden or forage for food should wash their hands after gardening and touching foraged products. Any food used for salads or cooking should also be thoroughly washed, and kitchen surfaces should be wiped down. I feel like these are all very obvious things that we should do when we're preparing food, but you know, you never know. This reminds me, this whole story has been reminding me about my time as a person who used to grow my own food. Well, not really all my own food. I used to grow kale. I loved kale for a portion of my life, and I would grow lots of kale in my garden. And basically, we would get a lot of like these little worms that would really love hiding in the kale leaves. And kale leaves are very curly, and so the worms would hide in there. And you could just wash and wash and wash your kale leaf. And then after all that washing, there might still be a worm that you missed because it was tangled up in the leaf. So even with lots of washing, it's still possible that you could miss something so small that's hiding in the leaves, which honestly just gives us more reason not to eat green things. Am I right? Fire King, you just caught COVID too. Oh no. Wait, so there was Bripe and then there was also Fire King that have COVID. Or you had COVID. I hope you're feeling better. Fecal oral route, the human centipede. Yes. Well, no. 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 The unspecified virus from an unspecified location. Yes, Gronk. Yes. Don't lie. No one really likes kale. Okay. I actually liked kale. The only way to eat kale is miserably or self-righteously. I actually would blend my kale in a smoothie with orange juice and bananas, and I would also put it into lentil stew. Okay, so moving along. So at this time, the patient continues to be monitored by the team of infectious disease and brain specialists. It is never easy or desirable to be the first person or first patient in the world for anything. That's true. This woman must be going through a lot. She's basically... case zero, as if we needed an excuse to not eat kale. This is true. Okay. We already read this. Let's look at the link in the Discord from Corey Campbell. Human neural larvae. Migraines caused by Ophidus scaris robertsi, and I'm going to keep butchering that name because I just can't say it. I can't believe that I majored in microbiology, which is notoriously full of very difficult names of different bacterial species. I would just read them. I would never say them out loud. Caff definitely ate her kale self-righteously. You can tell, right? I was the type of person who would just go outside and I would be like, I had my kale smoothie today. I feel so good. Yes, that's how I would go. You took time off work and everything and rest, and you took care of yourself, and you're taking care of yourself. That's good, Fire King. I hope you get better, or I'm glad you are better. Brave Traveler! Oh my goodness! How are you? Howdy, NS people are still... Oh, in the US, people are still vaccinated for COVID. In Europe, there was a big scandal with the vaccine, and the government buys a lot of the vaccines and they aren't used. Oh, wait, so I'm actually not familiar with the scandal that happened in Europe. I know that we still don't have our most recent vaccine for the most recent strain of COVID, which actually reminds me, I need to... get a booster. But yeah, I've heard that the adoption rate for getting the booster is quite low, and I'm imagining that's also the case in Europe from what you're saying. If you have a link for the scandal, I would love to read about it later. Actually, I can also just look it up after stream. The good news is we've figured out what's wrong with you. The bad news is we're going to name it after you. Scientists love Greek. Actually, there are some really cool proteins in the body that have been named after fictional things. So there's this protein and it's called Hobbit. It's actually a transcription factor. I believe it's a transcription factor. So it's only spelled with one B, not two. So don't get too excited. It's called the Hobbit transcription factor. Right. Let's make sure this is the right thing. It is encoded by the gene ZNF683. Nobody really cares. The reason I care about it is it was in a recent paper that I was reading about in these T cells. It's also expressed in human NK cells. So for those of you who don't know, I study cancer and natural killer cells and the immune response to cancer, specifically the natural killer cell response to cancer. And so there was this paper where they were characterizing different types of NK cells that were expressing the Hobbit transcription factor. Now I'm going to be honest, I don't really know what Hobbit does. It says here that Hobbit regulates the expression of genes linked to tissue retention and egress of lymphocytes. And this helps shape the tissue specific immunity. Okay, so this basically tells the immune cells, like it gives them signals whether or not they should go back to the lymph nodes or stay in the tissue. It's also one of the transcription factors that drives, basically it helps convert certain cells into innate lymphoid cells. Hobbit was originally named for homolog of blimp 1 in T cells. Okay, that's very disappointing. But anyways, I think it's a cool transcription factor just because it's called Hobbit. But that's a little aside. We're going to go back to what we were talking about. Yes, the new vaccine edition is coming out soon, next month. Every biologist I've met just likes to get looped and go streaking. Gronk, that's really good. Yes, as a microbiologist, I used to streak a lot of things. Not sure which brand of, or if all the brands are releasing new COVID boosters. I'm going to be honest. I tend to not keep up to date with COVID boosters as much as I probably should. Hobbits eat, collect knickknacks, and smoke pipe weed. Yes, or they direct your immune cells to become other types of immune cells. Okay, so moving along, this is the article that Corey shared with us. And this is the official case study of the woman with the roundworm in her head. Well, brain. Hello, my little I'm going to place that right there for you guys, because I can put links in chat. Felon! Welcome to the stream, Felon. Thank you for that 25 months. Oh my god. I think like you and who was the other 25 months? I just had a small brain fart. Blessing. Blessing. I was like, you in New Zealand. I'm like, what was their first name? I can't believe that. You and Blessing just hit the 25. Well, actually, Blessing hit the 26 mark. 26 months. I just switched back. I'm so sorry. I've been resizing my window to cut off the numerous ads that get shown here. This is probably better. If it's still cut off somewhere, let me know. I'll try to monitor it a little better on my phone. I'm just such a potato at this. Okay, so you should probably do the size thing in front of your face on the camera. This is the internet. After all, what? I probably should do the size thing in front of my face? That was a long time ago. Oh, yes. Yeah. Okay, let's catch up. Okay, so anyways, let's read through this article briefly. We aren't going to read all of it. And I posted the link in chat so you can read it yourself. But basically, this study follows the diagnosis of this 64-year-old woman who was first admitted into the hospital in 2021, and it was not until just recently that they formally diagnosed her condition. Basically, she had a range of symptoms that were characterized by abdominal pain, diarrhea, dry coughs, and night sweats, and they progressed to more severe symptoms, such as like depression and other neurological issues. And that is when they started looking more at her brain and they discovered the roundworm in her brain. So I'm going to just quickly scan this as I'm reading quickly. Okay. It also looks like they found things in her liver. So they say here they were doing a CT scan and they found hepatic and splenic lesions. So hepatic would be liver and spleen. The spleen is where a lot of immune cells are. Typically, a lot of the blood will kind of filter through the spleen, and it's possible that maybe the larvae ended up in the spleen, but they don't say that for sure. They also do a bronchoalveolar lavage. This is where they take fluid and they actually flush out your lungs. And then in this way, they're able to collect the immune cells that are in your lungs. So usually if there's some sort of like allergy or maybe in this case, a parasitic infection, your body will start to produce more immune cells. Specifically here, they were looking at eosinophils and they saw that there was an increase in eosinophils, but they didn't see any type of microorganisms present. They were looking for like helminths or parasites. They did serological testing. They looked for autoimmune disease, like different autoimmune disease markers. Usually this would involve looking for antibodies against things like your own DNA and other things. And so they gave her a corticosteroid. I think prednisone is I know it's a steroid, but I think basically it suppresses your immune response, I believe. And then 3 weeks later, she was admitted to a hospital and she had fever, so recurrent fever and a persistent cough while she was still on prednisone. What song is this from? Is it from Remnant 2? It might have been. We're listening to my moody, depressed music playlist right now, Gronk. Prednisone is a corticosteroid. Okay. Kind of like... it wouldn't fall into the same family as dexamethasone, right? These worms have been going all throughout her organs, leaving a trail of destruction. Yes, Friedman. And eventually they ended up in the brain. So let's keep going. So they detected... Okay, so they were looking at the heart as well as the liver lesions. They did a lung biopsy. And it says the lung biopsy specimen was consistent with the eosinophilic pneumonia. So I'm guessing there was a large presence of eosinophils, which honestly, so I'm going to be honest, I don't care about eosinophils. They are not relevant to my research at all. But let's look at a picture of them so we can give them some love. So they are a type of white blood cell. Okay. They have a role in cancer, but again... I usually will look at either T cells or NK cells, but you can also get a lot of eosinophils in response to like allergy, for example, but also like parasites and other things like that. They have an interactive diagram. Okay, that's very cool. This is new. Let's see. We're not going to go into eosinophils too much. If you're interested in that, you can always read about them on your own. Okay. So let's see. They also detected monoclonal T cell receptor gene rearrangement. Wait a second. What's happening? Oprah. Oh my goodness. We have gotten rated from Oprah. Oprah adopted me. Welcome in, Raiders. Oprah, it is so good to see you tonight. How are you? Welcome to the stream, everyone. Let's get a little shout out for Oprah. Oh my goodness, we have so many of you. We have Fake is Blake. If is already here. I was like, if. We have Witchcraft, J. Sammy, obviously Oprah. How are you? Cultural Lump. I like that name. We have Uber Chip. I'm good. How are you? I'm doing quite well. We are reading about the case study where the woman in Australia was found to have a roundworm in her brain. And they published a case study. I already closed it, but we can go back to that in a second. But they published a case study in the Journal of Emerging Infectious Diseases. And we're just going through the data, you know, very exciting thing to do on a Friday night. Okay, let me give you a shout out, Oprah. Oprah is a fantastic, wonderful streamer. I've had the pleasure of playing Dead by Daylight with him and met him through our dear friend, Patwick, who is sadly not here tonight, but I'm sure most of you know Patwick. He's someone that's hard to forget. In a good way. All right, here we go. Let's see if that works. Go give Oprah a follow, guys. This is Dead by Daylight. And
Oh my gosh,
you ran straight for him. Very brave. Yeah, Oprah is a very gutsy player. Let's turn this up a bit.
FDS.
He's very good at looping. I'm guessing this is what you're doing here. Okay.
Pick me up. Give me a hug.
Anyways. You should go check out Oprah. He plays a variety of games as well. So Dead by Daylight, as well as some very interesting retro games. So if you are into that, he also does Just Chatting and is a very entertaining and fun person to talk to. So go give him a follow. Go check out his streams. Thank you again so much for that raid. Oh yeah, Fire King is also a Dead by Daylight aficionado. you guys can bond over that. Yes. Okay. You, I'm here for it. You get a stream raid. Oh, yes. Okay. So anyways, for those of you who are not familiar with the case, I'll just quickly show you a picture of what this roundworm looked like when they pulled it out of the woman's brain. If you guys don't like worms and you don't like gross things, you probably shouldn't watch all of this stream. but let's see here. I'm getting a lot of ads, so please forgive me for whatever. So this is the worm that was originally pulled out of the woman's brain. It was let me find the picture of the brain too. Okay, I thought they did a scan. Here's the scan. I don't know if this is showing up, so I'll open it in a new tab. There we go. It's all nice and big. Now I have to just shrink my window capture momentarily. And we're a work in progress here. Okay, so basically here's the worm, and then the little white spot on this MRI is where basically where they first saw that there was something wrong, and you can kind of see this coiled object. If we zoom in a little bit more, you can almost see what looks like the shape of a worm, like a little shadow almost. And so this prompted them to perform brain surgery on the woman. She had a number of symptoms, so what ultimately led to them looking at her brain was that she was having just really strong depression, as well as some other neurological issues. They found this guy in there. Did the worm go in through the eye? No, so they are thinking that, they think she initially got infected back in 2021 through consuming some greens that she had harvested in an area that was known to have these pythons. They're called carpet pythons, and they are one of the main hosts for this little roundworm. And what could happen is that they might poop out the eggs or most likely the eggs in their feces on like the different foliage that the woman was collecting. And then she unknowingly ate the eggs, and then the roundworms hatched inside of her body. They went and disseminated throughout like her other organs first. So in 2021, she had a lot of abdominal pain and diarrhea. And so they were looking in like other main organs in her body. They noticed that there were potential like cysts maybe, or like these little, obstructions in her liver and spleen. But they didn't find any indication of a roundworm at that time. And it wasn't until a year later when the roundworm, one of them, there's possibly more, got into her brain that they finally discovered that this was the culprit for all of her many symptoms that she was presenting. But it took 2 years. Imagine being sick for 2 years and the doctors they don't know what's happening. It's insane. When you said you were rated by Oprah, you thought it was Oprah Winfrey. Close enough, right? So Oprah, when is Oprah Winfrey going to come for you? I can add you as a guest? What does that mean? Wait, what does this mean? Oh, it means I'm logging in. Okay, that's not what we want to do. Oops. You're waiting for the lawsuit? I don't think Oprah watches Twitch, so I think you're safe. The worms crawl in. Oh, yeah, right. Okay, enhance. Howdy, Caff and Chef. Oh my goodness, Hoju, hello. How are you? Welcome in. My head isn't much for worms and brains this night shift, so I shall bid you all adieu. Hoju, I appreciate your honesty. I hope that you have some rest. Hoju works very long shifts, so I'm guessing you're very tired right now. 3.3 inches is a little worm. Yes. Do you think that's a large worm? Okay, let's go back to the case study. Really quick. I have a horrible habit of getting distracted. You guys know this about me. But I am all over the place. I almost started looking at zombie worms because Ender mentioned that they didn't know what zombie worms were and I wanted to share with them. So now what this case study is basically looking at, and if you guys are interested in the science, you can also follow along with this link here that I'm posting into chat. But basically, this is kind of the story of how they were going about trying to diagnose this poor woman. So they were looking at, now they're looking at her T cells, and they noticed that there was a monoclonal T cell receptor gene rearrangement. They're mentioning a condition that I've never actually heard of before called hypereosinophilic syndrome. Now, I do know what monoclonal T cell receptor gene rearrangement means. Usually this refers to, in your body you have many different T cells and they all have different types of T cell receptors that can recognize different things. We refer to each set of T cells that can recognize one specific target as a clone. But I'm not sure how eosinophils drive that. Anyways, very interesting. I'm probably getting too bogged down in the little details. Because of her travel history, they were looking at all this serology, trying to identify other types of potential parasites. They gave her ivermectin as well, because ivermectin is known for being effective against different parasites. I think it's an adequate sized worm. Okay. They're kind of nematode. Yes, they are. Worms are a nematode. So then they looked at a CT scan. They were again looking at her liver and her spleen, but they were unchanged lesions. So they didn't really know what those lesions were, because when they tried to look for, like signs of parasites, they didn't find any. And then here, finally in 2022, so this is a year later, she started forgetting things and had worsening depression while still on prednisone. And then they also gave her other drugs, which I don't know what these drugs are. This is a type of antibody. Any type of drug that ends in mab is an antibody drug. Mepolizumab is used for the treatment of severe eosinophilic asthma. Okay, it recognizes and blocks interleukin-5. Interleukin-5, I think it activates eosinophils. So they were trying to, I guess, suppress. They're basically, at this point, they're trying to suppress her immune response. Because I think at this point, they might think that she has some sort of like autoimmune sort of reaction or an allergic reaction or something. Is ivermectin the one that's also used for animals for worms? Yes. Yes, Ender. So let's see. They provisionally identified, oh wait, here we go. Oh, so then, okay, so when she had forgetfulness and depression, that's when they did a brain MRI, and that's when they found that, like, little lesion that I showed you in that picture, and then they did an open biopsy, which is, like, open brain surgery, I'm guessing, and they found a string-like structure. They removed it, and it was a live and motile helminth, so it was wriggling. Oh. And then they performed these various things. Basically, they were, I think these are other types of brain procedures because they were also looking for other helminths and they did not find any. Okay, so let's look at the conclusion to see just like what is happening to her now. I think they're still monitoring her to see if there are any other roundworms present. Here we go. So they did a CT scan. She had unchanged splenic lesions. There was actually resolution of the lesions in her liver, which is interesting. They kept her on ivermectin and some other type of, I'm guessing, albendazole is a steroid, potentially. They gave her dexamethasone, which is an immunosuppressive. But then they discontinued the other drugs. So 6 months after her surgery, her PBEC. Ooh, I missed where they described what this acronym was. But anyways, basically she looked normal. Her neuropsychiatric symptoms improved, had improved, but they still persisted. So basically she's better, but she's not cured, which means there could still be parasites in her, which is really scary and really sad for this poor lady, who's basically a case study of, like, the singular case study of the roundworm infection of the brain in humans, one of the very first. So that's very cool, but also very scary. So you guys should be careful out there when you're interacting with nature. That's all I have to say. We basically went through this entire paper together. That's really cool. Thanks for hanging in there, guys. All right. So one more thing I just want to quickly show you to kind of gross you guys out. So besides this, there is another type of worm that can end up in your brain. And this one is much more common than roundworms. This is tapeworms. This is actually, it's considered a hidden epidemic because a huge number of people actually have tapeworm cysts in their head. So the cyst is just one part of the life cycle of the tapeworm. It's more of the dormant stage of the tapeworm. So people with cysts, they don't know that they have the cysts until the cysts start to degrade and then trigger an immune response. And this is a really cool picture. I don't know if it's showing up here. It's a really cool picture of a brain with cysts from a tapeworm. Kind of gross. But, oh, we have a new follower. Deeply talkative. Ugh. Welcome to the stream. How are you tonight? I hope you are well. Thanks so much for that follow. Hi, slightly. It's deeply. I do love that name. I never knew the fear of salad was a thing, but I think I have it now. Okay, but here's the thing, Nakura. Most of the time, your salad will be fine. I know there are cases of salmonella outbreaks that are in lettuce, which is very gross and disturbing. But generally, as long as you're not getting your leaves from nature, at least in an area where there's a known parasite, you should be fine. If you guys really do want to be afraid of going outside, we were briefly talking about Nigleria fowleri earlier because there was a case recently in Austin, Texas, where somebody died from brain-eating amoeba, which are also known as Nigleria fowleri. And I actually still have that really glitchy tab open. It's full of ads. I'm just going to highlight the title. Texas resident dies from brain-eating amoeba after swimming in a lake in Austin. Now, getting a brain-eating amoeba is actually pretty rare. In the past, like, 50 years, only 157 people have actually gotten this brain-eating amoeba. However, it is 99% fatal, so that's not great. And I did a deep dive on brain-eating amoeba, or Nigleria fowleri, a long time ago, like a year ago. Because I used to do this thing. I don't do it too much anymore just because of time. Grad school is really rough. But I used to do spooky microbes, and Nigleria fowleri made it on there because they're really gross and really creepy. This is just a computer-generated image. I'm trying to find like a real image of them. This is actually a scanning electron microscopy image, I believe, of a brain-eating amoeba. They have these, basically these little mouths that they use to like eat tissue. I believe they do trogocytosis. Do they do trogos? Let me see. Trogo. I am forgetting this word. What do they do? How do they eat? Trogocytosis has been observed. So trogocytosis is when a cell basically eats another cell. In this case, the amoeba is eating, literally eating the cells in your brain. And they use a little food cup, which is what was in that picture. The food cup is this. You guys probably can't see it. Sorry, it's cut off. My bad. This is the food cup on the Nigleria fowleri amoeba. And this is basically the mouth part that it uses to eat cells, specifically brain cells. I shouldn't be smiling like this because it is a very fatal it's very fatal. If you end up with amoeba in your brain, especially these ones, you're kind of toast. So it's a serious thing. It's a serious thing. And how do you get these brain eating amoeba? That's the scary thing. It's very random. Now it can be prevented. Usually what happens is that, it's usually in people who have gone swimming in freshwater lakes. Usually in the summertime, because these amoeba really flourish during warmer temperatures. And basically what happens is if somehow some of the water that happens to have the amoeba in it goes up their nose, the amoeba can travel through your cribriform plate into your brain. And it's scary because it could literally happen to anyone. It happens to old people. It happens to little children. It happens to young adults. So really do be careful. So there are probably a list of lakes, that are kind of like, they've been marked off as, places where Nigleria fowleri has been reported. So let me see, the first lake that, or basically the lake, where the person in Austin, was swimming before they got this amoeba and then died was the Lyndon B. Johnson Lake. Let's see if there's a list, 'cause this would be good for you guys to know. Lists of lakes where Nigleria fowleri is found. I'm pretty sure that people do, I'm sure they test lakes for them, for the presence of the amoeba. You'd think that they would have like scientists out there doing these tests. Like water maintenance and stuff. Let's see if I can pull this window over. Sorry, it's a little squashed again. Looks like the face of nightmares. Yeah, it's one of my favorite pictures. There are a lot of really nasty amoeba, bacteria, and so on that you can just get from playing in the dirt. I know, it makes you really want to just stay inside. Sean Courtright, welcome to the stream. How are you, Sean? I hope you're well. You never saw a stream like this before? You just read papers you find fascinating and teach us all stuff about health and stuff? You do the reading so we don't have to? You know, so I don't actually do this as often as I would like to or as I used to, but it is something that I do somewhat regularly or on occasion in the stream. I used to do it more. I'm trying to get back into it. But yeah, I really love anything related to microbiology and cancer. And then I like when I find something interesting that I want to talk to you guys about, I just go through the papers that I've read and then we kind of find new papers and we have new questions. This is why I like sharing things with you guys, because I don't actually have all of the questions in my head as I'm reading. And then as I'm going along and presenting this to you, some of you ask some really great questions and I'm like, oh my God, I didn't even think about that. So then I'm like Googling and like looking for papers here on stream to try to find the answer. And sticks for the win. For anyone interested in fowleri, you've posted the 10-minute Kurzgesagt video on Caff's Discord. Kurzgesagt is a great resource for fun, bite-sized science videos. You should go check that out, guys. If you aren't already in the Discord, you should join our Discord. It's a calm place. We're not a chaotic Discord. We're not like one of those really uptight Discords. We're a pretty chill place. But if you post weird things, I will kick you out. But anywho, you can go in there. We have a science section. We also have many other channels that you can maybe find that are interesting to you, and you can post things there. Ender. You know, gosh. Norm, you're just never going to swim again. First of all, Norm, welcome to the stream. It's great to see you tonight. So I used to really love going into freshwater ponds and lakes, but now I'm a little bit scared myself. There is a group in the city's health department that does that. Okay, so they should theoretically have a list. So let's see if we can find that list. Case reports by state of exposure. Okay. So do they just have a list? They have an Excel file, which I know it's going to download and then I won't be able to share it with you because I'm a potato. Do they have... I want the location. Number of cases... Of case reports by primary amoebic... So they call it primary amoebic meningoencephalitis. But basically that's the fancy term for... Oh shit, I have brain-eating amoeba in my head. So if you'll notice right here, they're looking at the month of illness onset. And if you'll look here, you'll see that the highest reported cases of people coming down with this amoeba is in the summer. So again, when the water is really warm. Then they have all the different types of water. You'll see that the most common type of water is lake, pond, and reservoir. There are some others like rivers and streams, and then some others that are represented. But they don't have a list of the lakes. This is by state. So the states that actually have a lot of these. So California has 10 case reports. Nevada has 1 case report. Arizona has 9 case reports. New Mexico has 1 case report. Texas coming in with a whopping 39 case reports. If you live in Texas, be careful. Make sure that before you go swimming in a lake, you check to see if there's been reported cases of Nigleria fowleri in that lake or river or stream. I don't know why you would be swimming in a stream. Just don't. There's been 4 cases in Louisiana, Arkansas, 7 in Oklahoma. So it's kind of all smattered out throughout the South. Florida has a lot of cases. So if you live in Florida, and I know a lot of you who do live in Florida, but there's 37 cases. Or 37 case reports that occurred in Florida. So again, if you live there, check the water. South Carolina had 8 cases, so somewhat high. So just be aware of these things. I'm sorry, I realize that my map is cut off again. My God. Here's the fully cropped map. Hopefully you guys can see that a little better. You just read the description. Your mother died of AML 5 years ago on Monday. Oh my goodness. I'm so sorry, deeply. Good. You're doing the Lord's work informing and helping people with these diseases. Thank you and God bless. Oh, thank you, deeply. No, that's really my hope. Like, at some point I thought about going to med school, but I found that, I thought that it would be more impactful for me to go into research so that I can hopefully at least inform and come up with new treatments. And better ways for people to treat cancer. If you were to eat fish or something from a lake that had these amoeba and the like, would it be easily contracted by eating the food unless cooked really well? So I want to say no. But because if you're eating the food, that means that the amoeba would end up in your intestine, and I'm pretty sure these amoeba do not do well in the high pH of your gut. But let's just Google this briefly. Can Nigleria fowleri survive the gut? Nigleria fowleri survive the GI tract. We'll do that. Okay. This is what I thought. Again, this is just me finding the first result on the internet. Not sure if it's completely right, but it says it confirms what I believed. Stomach acid is deadly to the amoeba. But I would be interested in seeing some actual studies about this. What is this? Here's a paper. Environmental, abiotic, and biotic factors affecting the distribution and abundance of Nigleria fowleri. What do? They're just looking at where in the world these amoeba live, but they're not looking at whether or not they can survive your gut. This is a paper on the immune response in Nigleria fowleri. Was this the paper? Oh, here's some really cool images. I think I showed these before. But basically, these are the amoeba. These are the little eating cups. They're little feeding cups. Those little circle donut things. That's where they attach onto the cells and chew away. So this picture, this isn't scanning electron, my bad. This is transmission electron micrograph. They call them trophozoites, which is one of the stages that the amoeba exist in when they're more motile. And they're showing their nucleus. So in A, the nucleus is the black thing. I don't know. Can you guys see that? And then in B, so panel B right here, this is scanning electron micrograph right here. So scanning electron microscopy it generates 3D images, whereas transmission electron micrographs are more like 2D. That's why I was confused, because I thought they were referring to the whole 3D image as a TEM, but it's not. So anyways, the little like white donut shaped thing is the feeding cup or the food cup. In C, this is a picture of a cyst. So the amoeba, they can survive harsh temperatures. This is actually interesting. Can Naegleria fowleri cysts survive the gut or survive digestion? Survive digestion. Because we do accidentally drink water from streams a lot, don't we? Here we go. This is talking about freezing temperatures, though. Temperature. So Naegleria fowleri is a heat-loving, thermophilic amoeba. It likes hot temperatures, hot springs, and the human body. It even likes fever temperatures. It typically grows best at temperatures that are higher, or temperatures up to 115 degrees Fahrenheit. That's quite hot. So you can see now why Texas and Florida are a hotbed for these amoeba, because the water temperature gets really warm. Not 115 degrees warm, but quite warm. Okay. So trophozoites, which are like the ones with the feeding mouth, like the little feeding cup, they can be killed rapidly by refrigeration. The cysts, however, can survive for weeks to months at cold temperatures above freezing. I mean, this is how we would expect them to survive the winter months. They need, for their survival, they need like this hibernation stage, and that is what the cyst is, which is the circle is the cyst. Okay, but they don't talk about eating them. Yeah, they don't talk about them going into your gut. Did this take us to a link? This took us to the Smithstone. I can't speak. Oh my God. Okay, I'm not going to say that word. It took us to this magazine that's very well ranked. So this is supposedly from a source where someone is saying that stomach acid can kill them. Let's try to... I like to backtrack to see exactly where they got this fact. But it looks like this link doesn't take you to anything that discusses stomach acid. So I'm not sure how they can say that that's the case. Huh. Okay. This is a useless article. Oh my God, the cyst could be transported in dust. This is from a research article in 1996. The cell walls of amoeba are very flexible. Yeah, that's why I assume that they should be very susceptible to stomach acid. The amoeba has to go into your nose. You'd never swim in a stream, but you'll chill in one in chat. Yeah, just make sure nobody splashes water up your nose, okay, Norm? That's good to know, at least. It seems more likely that eating something wouldn't harm you as long as you're careful and you wash your hands and so on. Yeah, but the one thing that could really F you up if you eat it are tapeworms. which I I was trying to talk about tapeworms, and then I started talking about Negleria fowleri again. Sloth! Oh my goodness, hang on. Sloth is here. One of our dear mods. Let's give you a little shout out. Sloth, how are you? Give you that. There you go. You were playing League of Legends.
I do feel like I spawned next to Randy.
You're already on that.
And he plays Fortnite. I actually met Sloth while I was playing Tarkov.
Randy, I can't even pull my gun out.
Many years ago.
Why is that a thing? You squirrely little bitch.
It's because your guns are so useless against Randy.
Sloth is a very wholesome.
No, they're just scared.
This is Fortnite chat.
Your guns are so useless.
Fortniters are a scary breed of people. Okay. Are tapeworms not killed by cooking? Yes, they are. So this is the thing. Tapeworms are killed by cooking. So when you eat things like raw pork, however, if you're eating improperly cooked pork, that is typically how people get tapeworms. Now, what can happen is, in this scary article right over here, this is a fantastic article, and I highly recommend you guys read it. It's not like a scientific article full of jargon. It's more easily accessible, but I still think it's quite good, and it references some scientific articles, so I think it's nice. Oh, you unlock something in Turkey. I don't know what that is. Stikes. Okay, so let's go through this article briefly. So here, this is about tapeworms. This is what happens to your brain when tapeworm cysts make it to your brain, and they can actually cause these holes. Now, the tapeworms don't exist as their long worm shape. I'm sorry, I'm going to show you guys some worms. So look away if you don't want to see them. I think this is where the worms... Yeah, oh God. So... these are tapeworms. These are multiple different types of tapeworms. There's many different species. The type that is being discussed in this article, let's see, I forgot the name of it, but it is, well, we'll get to it. Basically, so it starts off discussing rare infectious diseases. So there's a place at the NIH, which is the National Institute of Health, very big place. I have a lot of friends who used to work there, but basically that's where you can go see a specialist if you have like a very rare disease that your doctor can't diagnose. So here there's this guy, his name's Theodore Nash, and he treats people who have rare parasitic diseases. So... for example, like a blob in the brain. Okay. So let's get to the part. There's a part. Let's see. Okay. So he's first discussing the tapeworm epidemic. So in the United States, it's actually not as much of a problem as it is in other parts of the world. He estimates that there are about 1,500 to 2,000 cases of tapeworms in the U.S., but again, this is kind of an estimate. Worldwide, however, the number of people with tapeworm infections is higher. Obviously, it's hard to estimate on a global scale because the symptoms are not always present. The symptoms are this thing. It's basically called neurocystic chorosis, and it's most common in places that lack good public health systems because, again, this can be transmitted through the fecal-oral route or through poor sanitation. Now, what Nash claims is that there are 5 million cases of epilepsy from neurocystic chorosis. I don't know if this is per year, but this is basically, and I don't know if it's because of tapeworms. I can fact check that a little bit later, but that's a lot. That's a lot if that is from tapeworms. Hang on. I just want to fix my window again, being very... finicky about this. Sorry, I don't like the sidebar. Yes, I have one free article left. I know. Okay, let me just make sure. The accuracy. Oh, you're talking about the Tarkov guns. Okay, so moving along. So even in developed nations, figuring out how many people have the illness is difficult because it's easy to mistake the effects of a tapeworm for a variety of other brain disorders. So the clearest proof is that there's a ghostly image of a cyst in a brain scan along with the presence of antibodies against tapeworms. So what does it look like? What does your brain look like when it has a tapeworm in it? Well, again, you would look, you would use an MRI. MRI scans are kind of boring to look at. But here is a very, actually very stark and rather startling image of what cysts caused by tapeworms can look like. Now, if you are afraid of holes, I would recommend looking away. Some of these images are not good if you have trypophobia. But here is a picture, an MRI scan of someone with cysts in their brain. I don't know if that's, is this, oopsies. This is not centered. Okay. So basically the little tapeworm cysts will form these holes in the brain. So people who start displaying neurological symptoms, they'll go get an MRI and this is what you see. It's pretty disturbing, I think. Okay. So going back to here. I actually have a shirt that has like the little holes that look similar to cysts. It's kind of gross. Okay, so one of the common places where people tend to get tapeworms is in Latin America. So scientists and doctors have tried to kind of scan the populations to see how many people actually have these cysts by giving people like CT scans or MRIs. And also doing blood tests to look for like the antibodies against the tapeworms. In one city in Peru, researchers found that 37% of people showed signs of having been infected at some point. Earlier this spring, they published a review on this in scientific literature. If any of you are interested in neurocysticerosis, I can't say this word. Here is the link to the article if you want it. Oh my goodness, hello, Chazzy, welcome in. Welcome to stream, how are you? We're talking about tapeworms in the brain. They basically leave little holes in your brain. It's very disturbing and can result in epilepsy. Man, with that much damage, you would think that they would be having more problems than just starting to display symptoms. Yeah, so what happens is that the cysts are actually pretty, they stay dormant for like very long periods of time. And during this period of time, they're not actually causing any like immune response. So there's no symptoms. And they're actually, as the cysts start to like maybe grow, they might cause like swelling in the brain, and this can cause minor symptoms to start popping up. But it's still hard to catch. Okay. So, okay. Earlier, so in that article that I just linked you guys, the conclusion was that somewhere between 11 million and 29 million people have neurocysticerosis in Latin America alone, caused by tapeworms. Tapeworms are also common in other regions of the world, such as Africa and Asia. It's a very important disease worldwide, and we don't talk about it that much. The alarming illness occurs when a tapeworm larvae loses their way. Because normally, so the tapeworm that we're discussing is Taenia solium. So normally, it has a life cycle that takes it from pigs to humans and back to pigs again. So it really should not end up in a human brain. It should be in this kind of continuous cycle between pigs and humans. Also, I feel like my text is probably... Is the text a little small? I can make it a little bigger. Here, let's do this. Let's make it slightly bigger. Okay, there we go. Just so I know which part of the page I'm showing you. I'm sorry. Did you see the woman with the 8-centimeter parasitic worm in her brain? Yes. Actually, we spent the first like hour and a half of stream just discussing that. Don't apologize. That's actually how this whole topic started. And then I started reading about other parasites that end up in the brain. It's scary. The good news is that it's pretty difficult to actually have that happen to you. So, you know, as long as you stay in your home and you just do gaming, you should be safe. Okay, so basically the life cycle of the tapeworm is that adult tapeworms, they live in the intestines of humans. They produce 50 1,000 eggs a piece. That's per tapeworm. The eggs are then shed in the infected person's feces. Now, the person will continue to have the tapeworms living in their gut until they're detected, or maybe they poop them out. Who knows? But the eggs are shed typically through the feces. They shouldn't really linger in the human. Pigs then swallow these eggs accidentally as they rummage for food on the ground. Now, I'm trying to imagine, like, again, this is why this doesn't happen too much in the U.S. because we have sewage systems in place and, like, in other developed countries. But in undeveloped countries where they don't have sewage systems, I'm guessing that you have pigs just out and about eating poop. So anyways, the pigs end up with these eggs that have passed through the human. The parasite eggs reach the pig's stomach. The larvae then hatch and burrow their way into the pig's bloodstream. So this, again, could have happened in the roundworm situation where the eggs from the roundworm, like, were in the woman's stomach. The larvae hatched and then burrowed their way into the woman's bloodstream, which then traveled up to the brain. But again, just keep the two things straight. We're now talking about tapeworms, not roundworms. So anyways, the tapeworms, they end up lodged in small blood vessels that are typically in the animal's muscles. They form cysts and they wait until their host is eaten by a human. This is crazy, right? Like, how did the tapeworm know that pigs would be a delightful food that humans would eat, right? So in order for humans to actually get live tapeworms, the pork has to be undercooked. So this is, again, why you all should not eat raw pork. This is the reason, right here. You can get tapeworms. And actually, if these words aren't enough for you, this is the reason. These holes in your brain. This is why when you get pork, make sure it's not pink before you eat it, okay? All right, now that I've made this point, let's go back. Sometimes tapeworms take a wrong turn. Instead of going into a pig, the eggs can end up in a human. Like, I guess if a human eats poop from another human, or it gets, you know, like, they don't wipe properly, they don't wash their hands, and they go prepare food, the eggs could end up transmitting to another human that way. This can occur if someone shedding tapeworm eggs contaminates food that other people then eat. When the egg hatches, the confused larva does not develop into an adult in the human intestines. Instead, it acts as it would inside of a pig. It burrows into the person's bloodstream and gets swept through the body. Often, these parasites end up in the brain, and this is where they form cysts. I love showing this picture. The tapeworm larvae often get stuck in the ventricles or fluid-filled cavities in the brain. So the ventricle, if you like do a cross-section of the brain, it's kind of these like heart-shaped things, and that's where your cerebral spinal fluid is, and basically it kind of helps flush the brain out, but it's also a great place for parasites to hang out. So this is really gross. The tapeworm larvae get stuck in the ventricles and they sprout grape-like extensions. I want to see if we can get some pictures of tapeworm larvae sprouting, because that sounds delicious. Sprouting in ventricles. I don't know what to type. Yeah, and when you start Googling these things, you can start seeing pictures about how a tapeworm infected a man's brain, causing years of damage. It's very scary. Oh! Ooh, this is a tapeworm's face. See that pipe? I don't see a sprouting thing, though. Okay, so you can also see the ventricles from this angle, but again, I don't see the sprouting extensions in these various images. This is gross. Ooh, they now started censoring images on Google, which is, I think that's good because sometimes they show you guys really weird things, which I probably shouldn't. But anyways, I don't see pictures of sprouting tapeworms. So we're going to just continue. Let me catch up with you guys in chat, though. My parents always said it was bad for me to stay inside at my computer all the time. I should show them these articles. Yes, Ender, you should. How this whole topic started. I saw that you did there. Oh, yes. I've done a lot on cardio elements recently. I'm finding it really interesting. What is cardio elements, Chazzy? Reminder, the U.S. is having a large feral hog problem. This is one more reason to shoot them all. But should we eat them? Cook them very well. Slightly caffeinated. What makes things like tapeworms more likely in pigs than, say, cows? Is it just the pigs' closer proximity to and propensity to be in the mud and dirt and so on? You know, that's a really good question, and I don't fully have a good answer for that. I would assume it's probably
why,
what
hello,
you suggested.
My little coffee bean.
Oh my god.
To the caffeine club.
Lovely, Lou. Another 26-monther. Oh my gosh, we have a lot of OGs here today. Lovely Lou, how are you? Let's give Lovely Lou a shout out. Lovely Lou is one of our first mods in the channel and a very valued and lovely member of the community. Kind of a silent community member, but always there. And you don't stream. Oh, that's interesting. You should start streaming sometime. You're always glad to be here and not do my job. Lou, haven't seen you in a while. See, everyone remembers you. Oh my god. Sometimes I think that Lovely Lou is actually a 12-year-old. Yes, we did a marbles race and Lovely Lou missed it. Too bad. By the way, guys, if you're new here, we do marbles races every 20 subs, and the winner gets a caffeine care package of coffee or other interesting things that I find to put in a package and send to you. Yeah, I know it sounds sketchy, but it's actually not. I think you guys like those caffeine care packages. I like making them. They're fun. Okay, so going back to our little tapeworms. So yeah, I guess I don't really have a good reason for why the tapeworm likes the pigs more than the cows. It could also do with maybe how permissive the pig's immune system is versus the cows, but that's kind of a guess. Because again, these larvae are somewhat invisible to the immune system for the most part. Oh yeah, you want the 12-year-old Lovely Lou voice? Oh god.
Oh, hey guys. I got my coffee by the day. By the way, I'm Lovely Lou. It was super enjoyable this morning. Oh, great.
That's awesome. Okay. Let's go back to this. Oh, right. Okay. So somehow these grape-like extensions, they actually act to cloak the worm from the immune cells. And then it also acts to take up nutrients from the brain so that the cyst can thrive for years. As a tapeworm cyst grows, it may push against a region of the brain and disrupt its function. It may get stuck in a passageway. So this could be like a passageway that allows the flow of cerebral spinal fluid, stuff like that. This impasse can cause, hydrocephalus. So this is when there is pressure against the walls of your brain, and this can result in headaches, but also it can result in really dangerous things like comas and death. So this is bad. If a tapeworm cyst doesn't cause these problems, it may go unnoticed for its entire life. Are you guys able to see what I'm actually showing? Oh no. Oopsies. I'm like highlighting things and you guys can't even see it. That is stupid of me. I zoomed in too much. Why is my 15-year-old voice or my 12-year-old voice deeper than your 15-year-old voice? Because I I always go overkill when I'm trying to mimic things. Okay. Eventually a tapeworm cyst that can't move on its adult stage will die. So this could happen after many years, and this will finally signal to the host immune system, which will then result in a powerful attack. And in this case, this is when we start getting actual symptoms in the human. In many cases, the immune cells of the human will swiftly annihilate the revealed cyst, but oftentimes damage occurs. So basically the immune system can keep attacking the cyst, and this will cause the surrounding brain tissue to swell. For unknown reasons, a calcified cyst can keep triggering these immune reactions for years after the actual parasite is dead. So after there are anti-parasitic drugs that can be given. However, they actually trigger a higher immune response, and this can actually cause the patient to die from the treatment. So they have to also give the patient like immunosuppressive drugs, like steroids. Please say that in that voice. Oh no. Beware of microbiologists sparing gifts. I swear it's an innocent gift. Okay. Lovely Lou, fine for you.
I put it up my bum.
I said that in a British voice too. Oh God. Okay, I didn't ignore you, Lovely Lou. I take a long time to read chat. Any cyst in a susceptible area of the brain can cause seizures. Like basically this is why there's a lot of cases of epilepsy in people who are infected with tapeworms in their brain. Because the cysts could be lodged in regions that issue commands to muscles that trigger violent convulsions. This is really gross. Nash is the doctor, the special doctor. One of his patients suffered from a tapeworm cyst that twisted around his brainstem. After the tapeworms died, the inflammation that followed was so severe that it put the man into a coma. So eventually the guy did wake up after a few years of treatment, and he's recovered and doing well. But it's very serious if you get a tapeworm in your brain. So please cook your meat. Okay, so then they talk about some little drugs that they, in the 1980s, there's this drug called praziquantel. It's still used quite a lot for killing tapeworms. They are also talking about like trying to maybe like vaccinate or treat infected pigs, where this happens a lot. But of course, that's very difficult to do. To get all of the pigs treated. Okay. But yeah, again, one of the big takeaways from this article was that treating tapeworms is actually very preventable. It's just that nobody really cares about doing it, and like the places where people get most infected don't really have the money to like get treated, or they might not know that they even have tapeworm infections until they get screened, but they don't know that they should get screened. So this is really just a case of us needing to like, or of just needing like better public health initiatives to go out and you know, like provide screenings for people in areas where it's likely that they might have these types of tapeworm infections. Anyways, that's my soapbox. That's all I have to say. I could go into an article that discusses the immune response to tapeworms, but I also realize it's 10 p.m. So I'm thinking about doing a little bit of fallout, a little fun stuff. We've done a wide variety of things on stream tonight. We started off stream by sniffing things. Oh my gosh, if you guys missed it, I have a mystery box of scents and basically little perfume bottles, like 40 of them, 30 of them. And I went through and sniffed them. There was a many different weird things. What I'm going to do is every time I send a little note in the caffeine care package, I'm going to put a little sniff of the perfume on there, so you guys get to also smell the weird smells. But I'll ask and make sure that you guys don't have any sensitivities to perfume before I do that, because that is a possibility. Some of them are really bad. Like I put them all over my arm and I still smell, like there was a scent that was called I Am Trash. I put it right here. I can still smell it, and it smells like rotten melons. It's actually kind of good. I like smelling like trash. I think it might be my new scent. I just go out on the town and I just spray I'm Trash all over myself. I think that's going to be fun. And then the Fat Electrician. That's a scent. I actually liked that scent a lot. That one actually faded away, but it's also possible, because I am wearing my watch here, that it rubbed the scent away. No, wait, it's on my wrist. I still smell it, and it smells good. It smells kind of like pine and vanilla. It's very interesting. It smelled like a dusty drawer. But yeah, so we did a little of that. We did a coffee giveaway today. If you missed it, don't worry. We'll be doing some more in the future. And then we did a fun science-y chat. And now we'll do a little bit of fallout. Oh, do you want to add that? Oh my God. Damn it. Leb isn't here. Leb would normally add these things to our quotes. Which, by the way, if you guys ever want to see what kind of weird things I say on stream just to amuse yourself, you could do exclamation mark quote. And I do remember very candidly saying that my favorite group bonding experience was swabbing my butthole. It was. This was for a class, okay? This was for class, and we swabbed our own. It was a very private experience, but also a group experience, which makes it wonderful. We always go back to fecal matter here, like talking about weird things. That's why in Britain we have I have to say this in a British voice. That's why in Britain we have free healthcare, but our government is shit. I've heard that a lot of doctors are going on strike in Britain because they don't get paid enough. But yeah, I feel like that sounds just like our government and our healthcare system. Or wait, you said you have good healthcare. Wait, what did you say? Oh, you have free healthcare. Okay, that's not like us at all. But yeah, I heard many doctors were going on strike in Britain. I know that's happening here as well with, I believe, or was. Many different groups of people were going on strike. Caff, I added you back on Discord, just so you know. I wanted to ask you a few things about restarting my Twitch. Oh, of course, Jazzy. I saw your message, and I will definitely respond as soon as I can. Remember this evening's topic the next time you have a headache. Okay, so I just want to be clear. Headaches are very common symptoms for a variety of different potential reasons. It doesn't mean, like, the people who have parasite infections, they have headaches that just don't go away. Like, these are persistent headaches. They also have other symptoms. So if you have just a headache, like for an hour or so, that doesn't mean you have a parasite in your head, okay? Don't freak out. I'm not here to fear monger, you guys. I just want to promote you guys being cautious. That was not a real sentence. Chazzy, you've been looking at a lot of elements of cardio, thoracics, mostly surgery and stuff. Are you planning to go into the medical field? That's super cool. Okay, let me see, what else did I miss? Did I miss anyone else's chat? I'm glad the worst thing I've ever had because of a headache was a pituitary tumor and not a tapeworm. Oh, you had a pituitary tumor. Was it, I'm guessing it was benign and you're okay now, obviously. You're still here with us. Did you have that surgically removed? Actually, you don't have to answer that. I realize I'm now asking, like, personal health questions. Okay. Let's see what else. We are always in the need for more community health workers and health educators. Yes, absolutely. Yeah, I think I was listening to this podcast recently. It's by JAMA, which is the Journal of American Medical Association, and they have a podcast. There's actually, so I don't know if you guys like listening to podcasts and you don't like reading, because I don't always have time to read. I like to listen to podcasts more, but I like to listen to a podcast called the Immunology Podcast. I also like listening to the JAMA podcast. I will warn you that the Immunology Podcast is very jargon heavy. I listened to it with friends who are not in the immunology field, but they're also biologists, and I had to explain like every other sentence to them because it was very full of jargon. But it's a really cool podcast for someone like me, because they go through all of the most recent papers, or not all of them, but like through top recent papers in the immunology field, and I can just listen to it that way and get my, I don't have to like read through like Nature bioarchives. Well, they actually don't look at bioarchives papers. I'm not going to get into that. Bioarchives is a kind of like an archive system for non-published papers that you can look at on the internet, and it's actually available to everybody, so you don't have to pay money to go look at an article published, or not published, but posted on bioarchives. So I'll just post that link here in case any of you ever want to read science papers, but you get blocked by the paywall because freaking journals are just money-hungry conglomerates that are trying to destroy everyone's lives. But here's bioarchives. You can look at this website. They have all of like the newest articles are coming out there. I will warn you, they have not been peer reviewed. So they have been screened, but it's possible that there's still potential nonsense that's posted in these articles. So if something seems sketchy, just ask me. No, I don't know. Let's allow this. I'm hoping you get good enough grades this year in my GCSEs so I can go to med school after college. That's awesome. So are GCSEs like kind of like a standardized testing that you do? We do a very different system in the US, but then we do like SAT testing. But then after that, you still go to college and you do other things, and then you decide if you want to go to med school. It was benign, and yes, you had it surgically removed in my junior year in high school. Oh my God, you were a high schooler. Where they went up your nose to remove it. Oh, that's so scary. Oh my God. Well, I'm glad that they removed it, but that's still a big procedure for a high school student. I'm glad you're okay, Fire King. Does the immunology podcast have explosions? No, but one of the scientists that is on the immunology podcast, he's actually a big LARPer, and he talks about his LARPing adventures. He dresses up as a Middle Ages person. He dresses up like a knight or something, and he goes to these camps and like hits people with fake swords. But he's actually like a very smart dude and does like all these cool, like, he has credentials and he goes through papers, but it's sometimes hard to understand him. It's really cool just to see like these really kind of like stuffy scientists doing like fun hobbies that you would never expect them to do, like LARPing. I think it's awesome. The other person on the podcast, I'll be honest, I feel like she's kind of a stick in the mud. Her hobbies include reading, which I'm like, reading's fine, but we do a lot of that already. You did astronomically bad in your mocks. Oh, your mock exams. Ooh. Okay. Well, okay. So Chazzy, I have a recommendation for you. There is a YouTuber. I don't know how helpful she will be, but she goes through a bunch of different types of study techniques. Her name is Elizabeth Phillips. She's actually from Great Britain, and she is a medical student, and she is awesome. But she has a YouTube channel. I'm going to send you a link to her YouTube channel. And she has a lot of videos about how to study better and how to retain more information better. Basically how to organize your life. And I think if you're planning to go to med school, you should definitely check out her channel. So I'm just posting that here so that you can see that. But yeah, she has a lot of really good study techniques. Okay, I've missed a couple more of you. Oh dear. Nothing says... Oh, most of us here are F2P. F2P? When it comes to reading science papers, thanks so much. Oh yeah, I also have my other little tips and tricks for getting free science papers, which I will not disclose online, but if you ever have a question about that, just come and DM me. Can you take them more than once to improve your score? Oh, the exams. Yeah, I don't know the equivalent, but you've been learning about cardio and a little bit about neuro. You've been researching a benign acoustic neuroma my dad has on his left auditory nerve. Oh, I'm glad it's benign, but that's very nice and cool of you that you're looking into that for your dad. I would say that going into oncology, it's, well, I've obviously I'm not in med school, but I'm in grad school, but it's still pretty different. But I do think, like, I've interacted a lot with oncologists, and I think that overall they're pretty happy with their job. Although, I think if you go into pediatric oncology, I would say it might be a little bit harder. Just to like separate your emotions from your job, just because it is so tragic to have to basically interact with patients, like very young patients who have sometimes incurable cancers, like DIPG and stuff like that. But yeah, a long time ago, I wanted to go into pediatric oncology, but I realized after some internships that I was very emotional about it. And also I was very frustrated because, for example, there's a certain type of pediatric brain tumor called diffuse intrinsic pontine glioma. And in most cases, actually almost all cases in children, it's fatal. There's also an adult version called glioma. There's astroglioma and then a oligodendrocytic glioma, something like that. And they're a little bit easier to cure, but in children, it's typically fatal. And we obviously don't have a good therapy for them. And, you know, having to be a doctor who just can say, hey, this is what I have available to me. I don't have anything else. Maybe I can enroll the child in a clinical trial and maybe that will work, like whatever experimental therapy will work. But in most cases, the doctor can't really do much more than offer what scientists have already provided for them. So that is why I decided to bypass that step and just go straight into the discovery stage and be a scientist that tries to find cures for things like glioma. The GSC closest equivalent in the US is the GED. Oh, isn't everyone in the UK required to take the GSCE? Interesting. Okay. Oh, you also watch Elizabeth Phillips. Oh my gosh. I love her videos. She's an artist, a medical student, and she does a lot of really like nice mental health based videos on YouTube. Nerduino! Oh my goodness, Nerduino, welcome to the stream. How are you? Let me give you a quick little shout out. So Nerduino is a fellow sci and technology streamer and more focused on space. You talk a lot about really cool astrophysics type of stuff. Is it astrophysics? I think I'm wrong. More like astrobiology. There's a lot of astronomy streamers on Twitch. And I actually don't know too much about astronomy, but Nerduino does. So you should check out his channel. He goes through papers, which is really cool.
There you go. I'm glad you're still here, Sam Streams.
I don't know if you guys can hear the clip. Let me see if I can turn it up a bit. That is a sock.
Let's go jump on Mahoodles. That's who we're going to raid.
But you guys should check out Nerduino. I believe, were you doing like a star watching stream at some point? I don't remember. Okay, thanks, Kev. I need all the help I can get. Chazzy, if you ever have any other questions, let me know. Only people in the US are required to take the GED if they don't finish high school. Yes. There's a few societies for history LARPing that I know. Might be the one he's in since they're worldwide, depending on the shtick they're using, though. You know, he mentioned which LARPing society he was in, and then I completely forgot. Oh my god, Alpha Roth is here. Oh my goodness, Alpha Roth, hello. Welcome to the stream. Let's give you a shout out too. We'll give everyone a shout out. We got an Oprah raid. Let's give out shout outs like Oprah would. Okay. Alpha is also a streamer. He streams spooky games, lots of spooky games. He's a history buff. So if you like history things, do you ever talk about history on your chat, on your streams? I haven't caught the history portions, but I know you mentioned you like history. Let's see what pops up on this shout out. Mm.
Is that a thing?
This so
is
quiet.
A professional penis. Like the one you find in the Wikipedia when you type in penis. It's this picture here. Professional. The length of the shape is chosen precisely for that professionalism.
Your dick's small.
What are you? Okay, way, this is why I like shouting out Alpharoth, because you never know what you're going to get with his clips. And clearly, we got some juicy discriminating clips. Incriminating, not discriminating. Incriminating clips of Alpharoth being Alpharoth. Go check out his stream. It's a math sock. Oh my gosh. Okay, I have some really cool like biology socks. I'm not gonna pull them out right now because that's a little weird. But yeah, I do have my little nerdy socks. That's so cool. I'll have to get more socks. That seems like a weird transition. I'm alive because some people found oncology interesting. Thanks, guys. If that always makes me so happy to hear. And I'm glad that you're doing better and doing well. I don't know if I think I could do pediatrics. I already have a younger sister that acts like a four-year-old. And besides, I prefer the wonderful brain-rotting dopamine that comes from streaming. Yes. Oh, you could become an education streamer, actually. And it could be, you could use, kind of approach it from a twofold perspective. One, you're teaching other people, but then you also have to learn new things so that you can teach the people. It's basically like teaching. So I was a TA for a while, and this is what happened. I would go to lecture with all of the other undergraduates. I would take notes because the class that I had to TA for, so I had taken it as an undergraduate, but I had forgotten most of it. I had also taken a graduate level course, and so technically I should have known most of it. But anyways, there were some things that the professor taught that were very confusing. And I remember like the night before I had to teach the undergrads the topic that we were all kind of learning together, I would stay up like 6 hours and just try to teach myself the topic because I didn't totally understand it. But it was very helpful because for the first time in my life, I was actually able to really, really deeply understand certain topics that I had never understood before as an undergrad. Because as an undergrad, you're just kind of like, you get stuck in the rut of just memorizing. And you don't want to just memorize because memorizing, it's not helpful. You're just stressing out your brain. You don't fully understand how the concepts all link together. And so what I think you should do is when you're studying for a topic, you should pretend that you're going to teach it to someone. You could even do this where you try to teach it to like, maybe not your annoying younger sister, but you could try to like make a video because you might not have a person. And some people say they talk to a wall or a mirror and they try to explain the topic. You could do that, but I think that's kind of weird. But you could make like a tutorial video where you explain the concept that you're trying to understand in a step-by-step manner in a video. And if it doesn't make sense, then that means, okay, you need to go back and figure out why it's not making sense. I don't know. I know it's like not like a perfect recipe for success, but it's helpful. So I recommend that for you, Chazzy. Oh, you're welcome, Nerduino. I'm glad you're doing well. Astrophysics would be cool. Yeah. Ender is interested in a lot of astronomy things. Ender, you should check out Nerduino's streams. I think you would really like to see his topics because Nerduino, so I forgot, but you have a background in astronomy, right? And like programming, something like that. Ender is also a programmer. I feel like you guys would click really well. I'm just here. I just want to pair my chat with other streamers. I just want to like shuttle you off. Get rid of you. No, just kidding. Yes, I just want to see your sus clips, Alpha. You got me. There's no context that you can provide me to make up for that penis clip. We were talking about the picture on Wikipedia of the topic of penis. Why were you looking that up? Nothing helps you learn a subject more thoroughly than teaching. This is very true, Ipf. Here's a cool cardio fact. The muscle the heart is made of is called the myocardium, while the sac around the heart is the pericardium, and the pericardial effusion liquid in the pericardium is one of the most common life-threatening cardio-based issues. The liquid, is it because, why is the liquid life-threatening? That's actually super interesting. I didn't know that. You know what you might find interesting, actually, Chazzy, is heart regeneration research. So I have a friend, and she works in a lab where basically what they do is they snip off parts of... So they found out that zebrafish hearts can regenerate on their own, but human hearts can't. If a human heart is damaged, it's damaged for life. However, if you inflict damage to a zebrafish heart, it grows back. And they wanted to figure out, oh my God, why? So that's what she studies, and they look at different like growth factors and signaling that happens amongst the cells in the heart of the zebrafish, and they're hoping that they can somehow apply that or make a therapy for humans who have heart damage. Heart regeneration. It's a cool field. If you don't want to go to med school, Chazzy, go to grad school. You could be like me, happy and thrilled every day. I would talk to myself in the car, pretending to explain things to imaginary people. Oh, that's not too bad. People just think you're singing. What were you teaching yourself, Friedman? Arduino, you were a professional astronomer and you worked at NASA JPL for 10 years. Oh, that's so cool. I don't know. What does the JPL stand for? You've done programming and almost double majored in physics and astronomy. Ah, yeah. See? Oh, my God. See, Ender, you should chat with Nerduino. Your PhD in research was in theoretical cosmology. So a lot of building computer models on supercomputers. So theoretical cosmology, is this like trying to make theories and assumptions about the stars? I don't know too much about this. I need to sit through your streams and learn things about astronomy. When I was in school, I thought, who wants to be in school that long? So I didn't do it and just did computers. Stupidest mistake I ever made. Well, one of. I'm sure it wasn't a completely stupid mistake, Ender. I feel like every choice that we make in life, there's definitely regrets. Like, I used to think about my regrets all the time. One of my big regrets, for any of you who want to know, was not taking organic chemistry while I was in community college and waiting until I went to the harder, bigger school to take freaking organic chemistry and physics. I'll be honest, I suck at both of those topics. And what I should have done was I should have taken them at community college and gotten a better grade. But that's also taking the easy way out. So I do feel like I was challenged more, but I didn't get the grades I wanted to. So if you're trying to go into a field that requires a specific grade, be strategic about when and where you take your classes. You don't have to, because let's be real, when you're a doctor, you're not necessarily thinking about physics all the time, nor organic chemistry. Those things are not really at the forefront of your mind. So what really matters is getting the grades that you need to get into medical school, because it is super competitive and very difficult. And unfortunately, like, I just keep seeing the bar raised from these pre-med students every year, and like teaching them, you see that the stress levels are just increasing and increasing exponentially. And it's not good. I feel like at some point, you know, I don't know. What is the solution? But I'm rambling. It's usually due to a cardiac aneurysm when blood leaks into the pericardial sac. Oh, look at you, Chazzy. Dude, spilling facts here. I love that. How does one get a cardiac aneurysm? Is it common? Now I'm worried about my heart. Should I be worried about getting a cardiac aneurysm? I actually went back to school for astronomy about 7 years after finishing undergrad. Oh, so you worked for some time and then went back to grad school. That's actually, I feel like that's a good way of doing things, because you get some real world experience, and then you can be really, by the time you do decide to go back to school, you're really focused on what it is that you want to do in school. And you can basically achieve your goals faster, because you know what it is that you want, versus like if you go from undergrad straight into grad school, you might just be doing that because you don't know what it is that you want to do, and everybody else is going to grad school, so you're going to go too. And I don't think that's a good thing to do unless you're absolutely sure of your goals that you have for going into grad school. Like, you might have specific, like, I don't know, development goals. Like, maybe you want to become a better leader or a better independent scientist. Those are great goals to have. But you also need to have, like, a specific, not a specific, but you should have an area of research that you're really interested in. I think that was a hard part for me. I was interested in many things, which you guys can clearly see in my streams. My streams are very chaotic. I do a lot of different things here. That's kind of how I was when I was trying to decide what to do after graduating undergrad. I don't know. I was like, do I want to become a microbiologist and like work in like quality control and do food testing? That's really boring. Do I want to become a CLS, a clinical lab scientist? That seemed boring. What research did I want to do? I didn't want to study anything related to the microbiome at the time. I actually now sort of wish that I had gone into microbiome research, because there's a lot of really cool microbiome research happening in the field of cancer. Because what people have recently found in like very recent years is that our microbiome actually teaches our immune system and kind of trains the immune system. And in some cases, this can allow the immune system to respond to certain cancers better. And that's why some patients will respond to certain drugs, or, well, not really drugs, but they'll respond to their, they'll respond to immunotherapies, so therapies that boost their immune system better, because their immune system has been, has interacted with their microbiome, and it has kind of like maybe made them more activated, or it has, yeah, we're still trying to figure out actually like why this is the case. Like, why is the microbiome important? But we know that it is. So yeah, anyways. Yeah, so I just like tried a lot of things. I did a lot of different types of research, and then I decided I liked cancer. Like, not personally, but like I thought it was an interesting topic. Also, I realized I actually didn't want to study cancer originally, because everybody researches cancer, right? It's like one of those really like heavily populated fields of research. But I decided I would do it because I was more interested in the immune response, and that was something I hadn't really thought about before. And it's cool. That's cool. Oh, the heart regeneration. Imagine if we could genetically give that to humans. Yes, yes, that's exactly what we would like to do. No, Chazzy, you might want to consider research. Water doesn't compress and the muscle is moving inside of a sac, so less expansion. Ooh. Jet Propulsion. Oh, JPL stands for Jet Propulsion Laboratory, and it's one of NASA's centers located in Pasadena. Oh, I didn't know they had that in Pasadena. Pasadena is a lovely place. They have lots of good coffee there. JPL is NASA in California. I see. Jet propulsion. That sounds very cool. It's trying to make models of the early universe and how that leads to what we see today. Oh, very cool. Okay, so I'm guessing this is somewhat related to maybe understanding like how the universe is expanding, and like maybe how, like what the original size of the universe was based on like the expansion rate of the universe now. I'm probably saying like very silly things at the moment. I want to keep streaming, but I got to do my paper round, but I will put money on the fact that the stream has ended when I come back. You know, Chazzy, it might, because I have to wake up early tomorrow. I'm actually doing a very impromptu trip to Southern California. It'll be very brief. Otherwise, I would try to visit some of my little coffee beans down in SoCal. But it's a brief trip. But yeah, I need to wake up very early for that. So I'm actually thinking I might have to skip the Fallout stream today. Which is kind of sad, but also I know if I start it right now, I'm going to be up for another multiple hours, and I need to pack, and yeah, and maybe eat some food. I didn't really eat too much today. I ate some noodles. you do casual reads and watches on astronomy styles. You should also go check out Nerduino's channel. You would learn so much. You guys could have very fun educational conversations. Oh, I see, Chazzy. I see what you mean. So many great astronomy YouTubers out there. Yeah. If you don't have any regrets, you're either not living or you have no imagination. This is a good way of putting that, Ip. I like that. I have a math teacher at school that lets me come inside and we watch YouTube videos on the whiteboard at break and lunch when I don't want to socialize. That's awesome. I'm so glad that you have a really supportive teacher like that. I think like, so yeah, I think teaching is one of the most underrated and important jobs, and it's underpaid, unfortunately. But yeah, there's so many teachers that inspired me to like basically be where I am now. Like, I might not have gone into research because if I had not met one of my professors in undergrad. And even in high school, I also had a really cool math teacher in high school. Oh, that makes me so happy, Chazzy. Stop trying to force everyone into med school. Nursing or PA school is a valid option. Oh, yes. Yeah. I think that's the thing. A lot of students just automatically go into med school because maybe their parents are telling them to. Now, if you want to go to med school of your own accord, I think that's great. You absolutely should. You should pursue that. That's awesome. But you know, also make sure you do a little bit of research into what it's like to actually be in med school too, because it is hard. And I only know this from like secondhand information because I haven't personally experienced it. But like through friends and like also med YouTubers, I know that it's a very thankless field sometimes, but important. It's pretty common. Oh, the aneurysm. It happens when plaque builds up in the arteries, blocking oxygenized blood flow to either the left or right atria, which literally kills the myocardium, weakening the cardiac wall cells and allowing blood to leak through. So don't eat too much fatty dairy and stuff, because this stuff happens a lot more than we think. Don't tell me that. I want to eat my cheese. Ugh. No, it's good to be aware of these things. Okay, I'm still catching up. You've been chatting for almost 4 hours. How did I chat for almost 4 hours? This is the thing. As soon as I like start talking about amoeba or you know, worms, tapeworms, parasites, brains, fecal matter, I can talk for hours. I could go on rabbit hole. I could go down rabbit holes with you guys. Dr. Becky and Anton Petrov are two great physics and astronomy YouTubers. Oh, I haven't heard of them. Lord Friedman, I should have gone to bed an hour ago too. Taking a trip to San Antonio to help a friend move because I'm a simp. Oh, you know what? It's nice to be a simp sometimes, but also remember, you can always set boundaries. If you need to sleep or something, you should, you know. I'm a simp too, though. If someone tells me that they need help with something, I'm like, oh my God, let me just drop everything and go over there. And then I hate myself. But I'm sure that you will have a rewarding time helping your friend move, and you should go to sleep. And I'm glad that my content was interesting and that we had such interesting conversations tonight. I had a lot of fun. Yeah, Friedman, go to sleep. Go down rabbit holes. Do we do go down rabbit holes all the time. Yes. Yes, we do. And speaking of rabbit holes, just one parting picture to leave you with before you leave for the night. My favorite picture. Oh, no. Did I close it? No. Hang on. Hang on. We have to look at it one more time. My favorite picture. This is why you cook your pork. Okay, guys? Cook your pork so your brain doesn't look like this. Okay? We don't want holes in the brain. All right. So I think I'm going to actually end the stream now. I know I said I'd stream till 11 p.m., but I do need to wake up early. I know I only did one stream this week, too. I know it's a little sad. I will... Yeah, so I think I'm going to be changing my stream schedule to more weekend days from now on. So instead of Tuesdays, I will be doing Fridays and Saturdays. So for next Friday, we'll hopefully do some Fallout. Maybe we'll do Dead by Daylight. We'll do some type of game. And then Saturday, next Saturday, I want to do a microscope stream. We are overdue for a microscope stream. I want to go find tardigrades, which is my goal for next Friday before the stream. I don't know. Maybe Saturday morning I'll go look for tardigrades. Maybe Thursday night I'll look for tardigrades. I don't know. I know they're there. They're somewhere out there. I'm going to find them, and hopefully we have a tardigrade stream on Saturday. But I will keep you guys all updated in the Discord. So if you aren't already part of the Discord, join it so you get scheduling updates, because my schedule on Twitch right now is incorrect. If you guys want to follow my socials, there's the list. Instagram has some IRL stuff, more coffee stuff. You can catch a day in the life of a scientist with me on Instagram, or you can go to Discord, as I already mentioned, or you can go to my YouTube, where I post very strange, degenerate content. Or you could go to my VODs if you wanted to see a VOD. I will try to post a more concise version of our discussion on roundworms and parasites tonight, but I honestly don't know if I am going to have time to shorten a 3-hour conversation on parasites into a digestible, succinct video. So we'll see if that actually happens. If not, it'll be in the VODs, so you can always catch streams there. Chazzy, it was so great to see you. It's been so long, and it's so great to hear from you. I'm glad you're pursuing further education. And I wish you all the best with your exams. Also, Nerduino, it was so great to see you stop by. Again, guys, if you want to see a really awesome and amazing, knowledgeable astronomer streamer, go check out Nerduino. Nakura, thanks for coming by. It was so great to have you here. Also, let's see, did you send me... Oh my God, I'm already forgetting. You won the caffeine care package, right? I have to go back and watch my VODs sometimes because I forget who won, because I was like, yes, they won, and then someone else will win. Nikira, was it you? I think so. Yes, you did. Okay, send me a DM so I can figure out where to send the coffee. I will send you some coffee beans from NorCal. Corey Campbell, thank you so much for popping by the stream today. It's so great to have another valued member of the scientific community here. I think I actually might have followed you. I did follow you because you stream neuroscience.
Why, hello, my little coffee beans. Welcome to the Caffeine Club.
Lord Freezes! Need to do a collab stream soon. I know you're still at work. I'm actually ending the stream, but we should do a gaming stream next week. Maybe some demonologist. I'll be streaming Friday and Saturday. Saturday won't be a gaming stream.
You want coffee? If anybody wants coffee, I'm making the coffee. What do you want? You want coffee? Yeah.
We always want coffee. All right, I'm shouting out Corey Campbell. I don't know if you have any clips, but I know that you're streaming.
Vilifying,
right?
As unethical, right? If you call something unethical, it's like retro oh, shit. Games. Like, people take it a little more seriously. Ooh. But if we're looking at these, like this idea of money, right? Like money is like the medium of exchange, storage value, et cetera, et cetera. And when you look at these sites like Kickstarter, GoFundMe, or whatever, you're signing off on the terms of service. Like all these terms, I'm gonna try to choose my words more carefully because I think my lexicon might be a little too spicy for the panel, but you are not
I don't know what he was talking about. Oh, you stream? Okay, I know you were streaming science, but I was like, oh wait, what is this group discussion? I will need to catch one of your streams. I just realized you were a streamer a little while ago, so yeah. You have strangely good luck with marbles on stream. Yes, this is true, Nakura. Thank you so much for being here. If also Styles, thank you so much for being here. I know that you are probably tired, but I appreciate you being awake. Oh my God, you need to wake up for your Baldur's Gate at 11. Go to sleep. Go to sleep. Okay, we're going to find a lovely person to raid. I'm going to look right now and see who is live. Mahoodles is streaming. Oh my God. So I've never actually overlapped with Mahoodles. She is an astronomy streamer that I like to watch. She's playing Starfield, and I know Styles is super hyped about Starfield. So we're going to raid Mahoodles. This is not even a question. We are going to raid her. She is lovely. I think you guys will enjoy her streams. And again, she does a really nice mix of science and gaming. And yeah, I hope you guys enjoy. Oh, it's a discussion panel. I see. Yes, you're going to be late to deliver deforestation. T to the senile people paper round, so I'll DM you later. Oh no. All right, Shazzy, good luck with your exams. If I could sleep, I would, but I can't. Oh, Styles, I hope you can get some rest. Okay. All right, Glenn. Oh my God, Glenn, you're still here. Oh, okay. So lovely to talk to all of you wonderful people. Oh, we need a raid message. Oh my God. I almost got distracted. Leb. Oh, goodbye, Leb. Okay, we're going to do a raid message because I want to go into Mahoodle's stream with a bang. So let's see. If you have access to the subscription emotes, you can do this raid message. I have very boring raid messages. I haven't thought of something snarky to say. I'm not really that type of person sometimes. Or if you don't have access to, if you have the follower emotes, you could do this raid message. So many options, many types of beans. You can also spam your favorite emote. If you want to be weird, you can spam the feet if you are a weirdo like me. All right, so we're gonna raid Mahoodles now, and I hope to see you all next Friday. Have a lovely week, and we can stay in touch on Discord or the socials. I hope to see you there.